the message I felt like God put in my heart today, it's just a one simple word. I don't feel like I'm going to be long, but just this. Don't wait till you're ready. Here's one of the biggest lies of the enemy. Is he talks to people, and the enemy just gets in and says, you know, you feel that burden, you feel that inclination, you want to do something for God, and you have something in your heart to do, but you just feel too sinful, you feel too like you missed it too many times. God, you just feel like, I'm not ready yet. Wait, I gotta clean up my act a little bit more. I gotta get ready. You know, some people even use that excuse for salvation. They're like, well, just let me go clean up my act a little bit more, and then when I get clean, then I'll be ready to serve God in that capacity. And I just feel like God is just, he's got a word tonight saying, do not wait. Don't wait till you're ready. God is the one who makes you ready. Let's go to Philippians 2, verse 12. And you really got to read the whole thing, the whole verse, chapter 1 and the first part of chapter 2. But 2 verse 12 says this, just to get the whole context. It says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed. And Paul's not talking about obeying him. He's the context is he's talking about obeying God. Because verse 10 says that in the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and of those on earth. And of those under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord, or Jesus is Master. That word Lord means Master, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved brethren, as you've always obeyed, not so much in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. Paul's saying much more, because Apostle Paul was arguably the most intense, passionate Christian that has ever lived. I mean, this guy was nuts. He's like, I don't want to get married because it'll hinder my effectiveness for the gospel. He's like, anything that gets in my way, he's just like, I'll get it out of my way. Every hindrance, I mean, he wrote 2/3 of the New Testament that we read every week in church. But Paul was intense. And so he's like, I'm not there in Philippi anymore, so you guys need to obey God even more. Was basically what he's saying. I love the next bit. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Each one of us needs to do that before God and with Him and before Him alone. You're not going to get in because your grandma is praying. It's because your grandma walks with Jesus. Praise God that your grandma walks with Jesus. But it's you. You. Each one of us is going to have to stand before the Lord. Each one of us is accountable to Him. Each one of God wants us to have a personal relationship with Him. Verse 13, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for His good pleasure. I like that a lot. It is God who works in you both to will. That word to will means to have the desire. God is the one who puts that desire in your spirit. It's God who works in you both to will and to do according to His good pleasure. Man, there's so many times where I've stood up and just said, God, you're going to have to move. Because what am I doing? I have nothing left in me. And even, especially when I'm in England or just traveling or, you know, it's just been a long day and it's 12 o'clock at night and I'm driving home and I see a group of young people and God says, go talk to them. I'm like, oh, I have nothing in me. I've just spent it all today. And He's like, just go. And I go and people get healed and God moves, and it's just like, he so wants to do that. I feel like one of the things that he shuts down a lot of us, is we're waiting for this magical moment when we're going to feel like we're worthy enough to do something for God, or to walk with Him, or to start a cell group, or to evangelize. Sometimes it's like, well, if I went out and preached to somebody, if I told that person what a hypocrite I would be. No, you wouldn't be a hypocrite. You would be obedient to God. Paul's saying, obey. Not just when I'm with you, but now much more that I'm not in Philippi anymore. You guys got to step up to the plate. There has been, I'll just be totally honest, this is confessions of a pastor. There has been times and I'm like, God, I just sucked that week. And you want me to get up and you want me to preach? And He's like, yes. He's like, why? Because it's not you anyway. It's my grace that's flowing in you.
Come on.
Man, when I don't feel holy, when I miss the ball and stuff, it's then that I need His presence and I need His voice more than ever. It's His grace that the same stuff that saved me, I didn't get saved because I did a bunch of good works. I got saved when I received the grace that comes from Jesus, from His cross, from His blood. That same stuff that saved me and gave me a foundation in the kingdom, that brought me into the kingdom, is the same stuff that's going to grow me up and mature me. And even, man, I've seen God use, you know what God uses in the Bible? More evil people than righteous people. You read through the entirety of the Bible, most of the people He uses for His purpose are evil. And they don't know they're being used by God, but he situates things. How much more could He use someone who's just saying, here I am, Lord. I know that I suck a lot. I know there's a struggle. There's stuff going on inside of me, but here I am, God. See, I think that I feel like the enemy keeps a lot of people in a place of bondage and in a place of uselessness. In not uselessness as in you are useless, but uselessness as in you're not bringing forward, there's not an energy in your Christian walk, there's not a passion, there's not a fire, there's not a purpose, because you just feel like, I'm not worthy. And the truth is, apart from Jesus, you're not. But as soon as you call on His name, He makes you worthy. He says, I'm going to give you desire, and I'm going to be the one. God is in you, both to will and to do. It's His power, it's His grace, it's His anointing, and He puts it on you and says, now you're worthy. It's instant. The more you hang out with Him, the more you spend time in His Word. I mean, tomorrow, I tell you the truth. I have nothing to do, except I have one. I'm having dinner with John. He's ordering me pizza, and we're going to have some dinner together, and that'll be good. But I tell you, the whole day, I'm going to spend in the Word, and I'm going to spend in prayer. Probably the cell phone's going to get shut off, and I'm just going to spend time with Jesus, or at least on vibrate. But I'm going to spend time with Jesus. Why? Because I need it. When I spend time in His presence, His grace and the substance of heaven, His revelation, it accumulates in my heart, and it gives me something to say. It gives me something to be excited about. Everybody needs purpose and substance in their life. People call, you know what? I'm guilty of substance abuse. I'm guilty every day. Well, not substance abuse, it's not abuse. But I'm guilty of partaking of substance. My substance of choice is the grace of God. It's His presence. It's His love. I mean, I need it. I need it every day. Sometimes I'm like, God, I haven't felt it for a while because I'm getting stronger. I've gotten stronger over the last, but sometimes I'm like, God, I feel like a little orphan boy, and I'm just like, what am I doing? I need you, and it's awesome. His love just comes, His presence comes. As you spend time with Him, as you seek Him in your bedroom, you will find Him in the secret place, His presence. Man, everything I'm saying to you right now, I've lived. Because I believe you can only really speak with authority over things in areas that you've really lived and that you've really gone through. But I tell you, I face that thing where I'm like, God, I should probably quit. And God's like, I'm the one who made you who you are. I'm the one who's risen you up. I'm the one who puts my words in your mouth. Go. It's my grace. It's not a license to sin. And trust me, I mean, I can stand before you and say, I live a holy life. But because of His grace, it's changed me. I mean, over the years of walking with Him, you know, year one, it was like giving up ungodly music and you know, lust, basically. Girls, no, I never, Yeah, well, but it wasn't like perversity, it wasn't like sex or something, it was like vanity. I cared about my appearance. And God had to strip me of that. He's like, who cares what people think about you? The biggest thing, infinitely more important than what you look like on the outside, is your heart condition.
Come on.
Infinitely. God is looking at your heart. That's why I don't dress up. I mean, I dress normal every day. Sometimes I like to wear a nice shirt or something on Friday night, but you know what I'm saying? But that doesn't matter. It's the inside that matters. One of my favorite verses is in 1 Samuel chapter 7. 6? 16 verse 7. That's it right there. I'm out of it. And it says, God does not see as man sees. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And then it's the grace of God that purifies a heart. It's the Holy Spirit that brings that purity to our lives. It's only Him. Verse 14 says, do all things without complaining and disputing. Man, that's a really good verse. A lot of us need that one. Do all things without complaining and disputing. Do all things without complaining and disputing. You know, one of the number one things that the Israelites struggled with and that drove them into bondage was a complaining spirit. They complained about everything. One of the most annoying things for a pastor is people that complain. I'm like, man, you got a brain? Figure it out. See, but what happens is we're used to this consumer mentality, and we're used to this mentality where we don't have to think. And God, I did a four-part series that I called Think, that we would be believers that turn on our brains. It's a whole other message. But do things without complaining, without arguing, that you may become. Everyone say become. Okay, that's an important word, because some of you don't feel like what I'm going to read right now. Blameless, innocent, children of God, without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Some of you guys are like, I'm part of that crooked and perverse generation. Become, so that you may become. As you start relying on God, as you start giving Him your words, your will, He gives you desire. As you start stepping out into His calling, you become blameless and innocent. And it is a journey into innocence. Ask feel, God is the ultimate, our Heavenly Daddy is the ultimate one who restores innocence. Yeah. He is so good at it. He's so brilliant when it just comes to Him, just coming into our broken areas. And we say, God, this is all my broken heart, all my broken pieces. You're like, all right, I'm going to walk with you. It'll be a process. You'll have to become. Not going to happen overnight. But you'll become innocent. And it's a process. I've had people before, and I don't know if this is good or not. Like I want to be like so loving, and I want people who come to me and just had these different struggles, and I just look at them, and they're like, or I look them in the eyes, and they just turn away. They're like you're looking right into me, like something's wrong. They just feel convicted because I'm looking at them, and I'm like, you're looking into innocent eyes. The Father has restored my innocence. I am pure and holy and blameless before Him because of His holiness and purity and blamelessness that flows into me.
Yeah.
It's the grace of God.
Hallelujah.
It's so awesome. This is the gospel. This is the kingdom of God. This is why we're here.